This is the fifth season of the Joey Wright Show, our second episode. I'm your host, Joey Wright. Joining us today, Larry Larson and Josh Schwamm, both fellow sports communication majors at Bradley, joined me for about a 30-minute phone call. We talked basketball, baseball, Bradley, and more. I think it was a great conversation. I think you will think that, too. They join me after the break. Keep watching. This is Urbana Public Television. Welcome back. I'm honored to have with me on the show today my friends Josh Schwamm and Larry Larson, both fellow sports communication majors at Bradley. And Larry, we'll start with you. Joining us on short notice today, you are on the road to Wisconsin right now.
Yes, I am. Family vacation time. Called on the last minute, but it's always a pleasure to be on the Joey Wright Show.
Absolutely. Great to have you back for the second time. Josh, this is your first time on the show, joining us all the way from Atlanta, Georgia.
Yeah, I'm honored to be on. I was called a little more in advance, so I'm a little more ready to be on the show, but yeah, it should be fun.
Absolutely. The original plan for today was to have Josh Schwamm come on with our friend Shay Barney. Shay unfortunately had to cancel on us today, had a Topgolf reservation pop up at 10 a.m., so we hope hope he's having fun there. But I want to start, guys, with a little bit of basketball because the NBA is, even though it's the offseason, it almost seems like the NBA offseason is as intriguing as the regular season, the NBA draft just a few days ago. Josh, tell me about the Knicks.
Yeah, so the important distinction is, yes, I live in Atlanta, but a New Yorker through and through, the proudest resident of the greatest city in the world, born and raised, so... Yeah, the Knicks are kind of a train wreck. It has been a train wreck since 1973 when they won the championship. I was a little upset not to get Zion. I think a lot of Knicks fans have kind of penciled it in that Zion was the guy and like he was going to fall to us somehow. But our deal with the devil from the Patrick Ewing folding incident allowed us to fall to number three. But I was thinking about it after the initial shock, I guess you could call it, and RJ is far from a consolation prize. RJ Barrett was the best prospect in college basketball. So there's really, you could do a lot worse. He was the best prospect before the Zion show started. And the Knicks need everything. So according to the ESPN graphic, they need literally everything and have needed everything for a while. So it's a strong piece to build around, and I don't know how upset you can be. So as far as the draft goes, it was good. As far as the season goes, I'd be happy with 25 wins.
I was just gonna mention that Chiron that said the Knicks needed everything. But where do the Knicks go now that they have RJ? What's the piece that they're gonna add this offseason? It looked like they were gonna get KD. Now it doesn't look that way anymore. Looked like they might get Kyrie. Doesn't look that way anymore. He'll go to New York, but likely to Brooklyn. You know, what's the direction for this franchise?
So here's my philosophy on the Kevin Durant thing. Yeah, he's hurt, and his likelihood to stay in Golden State while he's injured goes up. But if I'm the Knicks, I would still offer him the max right now. I mean, it's a very severe injury, and really only one or two guys in the history of the NBA have come back from at peak form. But I just don't know where else they go. Kyrie is a cancerous teammate, and we found that out in Boston last year. And quite frankly, if you were happy to wear Boston on your chest, I really don't want you to wear New York on your chest. And he's not the guy that I want affiliated with the media. He's going to cause issues with the media. He's been a bad teammate the whole nine yards. I don't know who else is there. You know, Durant is top five guy in the NBA, top 20 guy all time. And if you take the chance, like the Knicks, they haven't won in 40 years. I don't know what they'd be waiting for. You know, this is a generational guy who, if he wants to come to New York, I don't blame him. Although the one thing that I would like to point out about the Durant thing is there was never any rumor that said Durant wanted to go to the Knicks. It was more of a, hey, the Knicks have cap space and they need a superstar and it's New York. And then rumors started to circulate, but I don't know how legit they were. I'm worried that people just kind of talked themselves into it being able to happen, much like the Zion thing. So I'm skeptical, but I'm optimistic. I would offer Durant the max and I'd sign him to it immediately. And I don't really know. I mean, Kemba Walker is from the Bronx. Cardiac Kemba originated at Madison Square Garden against Pittsburgh in the, I believe it was 2010 NCAA tournament. So, I mean, you guys just start building, right? The Knicks have nothing. And anything is going to be better than what they have right now. And so it's a multi-year process. So I'd go, I mean, if Durant wants to come, take him. But I'd just take anybody, really.
Absolutely. And now we've got to give Larry a chance to talk here. Larry, I know you're not the biggest NBA guy, but tell us a little bit about the Chicago Bulls. Kobe White, a lot of people are high on Kobe White.
Yeah, sure. I don't follow the Bulls that much, but I, of course, as a Chicago sports fan, it's impossible to avoid. And the consensus seems to be that Kobe White was the right pick, especially in the seventh slot. And going off of you asking Josh what the Knicks need and everything, it seems like the Bulls kind of need everything except guard play. They've got Zach LaVine, who played very well in the guard position, and a number of other guys that have gotten the job done, but it seems like they've been plagued by injuries and just, quite frankly, lack of talent at every other position. And it seemed like this year they were trying to tank a little bit, and Kobe White seems like a good guy to build around, especially with Lauri Markkanen. So a young Bulls team that has a little more potential this year than last year, it seems like.
Yeah, and just one more thing on the Bulls is that, I mean, it was very much considered that this was going to be a three-person draft, and I think that was wrongly decided. There's a lot of talent in the top 15 and strong pieces, and especially, like Larry said, he's a good piece to build around. Kobe White scored a lot, took a lot of shots at UNC, but because he had to. And that's a very good pick for them. You got Markkanen, you got good guard play. They're really only a couple pieces away and definitely a lot closer to being a contender than the Knicks are.
Absolutely. Now, do you see the Bulls doing anything in free agency this offseason? Question to either of you, but we'll start with Larry.
Yeah, I kind of doubt it. I feel like this is going to be another rebuilding year for the Bulls, even though they're a team that's in a big market. They generate a lot of money, and if I'm not mistaken, they do have a max slot, but I feel like even with a superstar on that roster, it'd still be difficult for them to contend, possibly for a playoff spot, but still, there are a few pieces away. I feel like it's more than one superstar. But we'll soon find out. The NBA offseason tends to be kind of unpredictable.
I mean, it's the same kind of thing with the Bulls. Like, they're just a few pieces away. Although the name that has been floating around for the Celtics, the Knicks, the Nets, and the Bulls is Malcolm Brogdon. He's a restricted free agent from Milwaukee, but if you make an offer that the Bucks just can't match and they're scared of trying to keep Giannis and they want to make sure they can keep Giannis, that's a young player who's really good, and you've got Kobe White, Brogdon, LaVine, Markkanen, Wendell Carter, who was taken last year in the top 10. That's a really good young nucleus, and Brogdon with some experience can kind of lead the way. So I don't know if that would be the dumbest thing they could do. I don't know if they'll do it, but certainly an option for them.
Absolutely. And, you know, I personally would hate to see Malcolm Brogdon leave Milwaukee, because I just love to see that team and that city do so well. You know, just a couple of wins away from the NBA Finals last season. Obviously, Larry, we can get to Toronto and Fred VanVleet in a minute, but it just seems like Milwaukee, that's a fun team to watch. Great fan base, and I hope that they are around for years to come.
Yeah, they're always a fun team to watch, and quite frankly, as a Chicago fan, I hate to admit this, but Wisconsin sports fans are some of the best in sports, and whenever one of their teams goes far, the whole city rallies around them, or the whole state.
Absolutely, and now I want to switch gears a little bit to the Toronto Raptors. You talk about a whole city, whole state rallying around their fan base. How about a whole country and the nation of Canada rallying around those Raptors? And Fred VanVleet voted Rockford's favorite son in a Twitter poll I did a few weeks ago. Larry, of course, you're from Rockford. Tell us a little bit about what he means to that community.
It's really hard to describe, because his presence is felt, even though he's in Toronto playing basketball, and the influence he has on the city is really unreal. And Rockford, a city that is not known for really positive highlights, this has been unbelievable to see all the positivity that his performance has generated, and it's really inspiring, even to somebody who isn't the biggest basketball fan. I went to the watch party that the city of Rockford put together for the final two NBA Finals games, And it was really fun to watch. It was a great atmosphere, and the whole city really rallied around him and the Toronto Raptors. And it's really good to watch. And I made a YouTube video for one of those, and it's only 8 minutes, and I feel like it captures the essence of what he means to the city. And he's really inspiring to everybody from adults to young children, and he's a really good influence and represents the city well.
Absolutely, and in his post-game interview after the Raptors clinched the NBA championship, he called out Rockford and you know, kind of tied it back into, you know, tied everything together there. That was pretty cool to watch.
That was very cool. It definitely a chills moment to watch that live. That was awesome.
I bet Rockford, of course, or rather Van Vliet, from Rockford, then to Wichita State, and then to the... Has he always been a Raptor?
Yes, okay. He always has been a Raptor. They were the first team to give him a chance, and he stuck with them.
Absolutely. So switching gears now to baseball, Toronto's American League team not doing as well as their NBA franchise, but, you know, of course, you look at Josh Schwamm, a Yankees fan, and Larry Larson, a Cubs fan. Guys, how are your teams doing here as we approach the All-Star break? The Yankees, 48 wins, 27 losses. I don't have the Cubs record pulled up. I'd have to scroll down here on the page I'm looking at. But looking pretty good for both of your teams.
Go ahead, Josh. Okay, so it's been pretty good so far this year, considering we have all these injuries. And we're look at the standings here. 4.5 games up on Tampa, and it's been a lot of fun to watch. I mean, it's very nerve-wracking, but we're looking really good. The injuries are coming back, and when we get those injuries back, it's going to be just kind of a train getting those guys back rolling, and I'm excited. I'm really looking forward to what's ahead. I'm not really worried about Boston, which I know is the cursed thing to say, but they're 7 back. They've struggled, and I think their magic is kind of run out. Tampa, I'm not quite convinced is for real, especially having been to my fair share of Rays games. I don't know if that team can sustain success for that long. They lose interest. The fans lose interest, and it's not fun for the players, I don't think. And they were really good earlier in the year, but they've kind of fallen off the wagon. I'm excited. I'm really looking forward to beating up on our friend Matt Harrington's Twins in the playoffs. And I'm even more looking forward to, at some point in our 4 years at Bradley, the Yankees playing the Cubs in the World Series, because that would just be... I love being the enemy, so it would be great being in Peoria for a Yankees-Cubs World Series.
Well, Josh, you mentioned that Rays fans lose interest. I don't think they ever had any interest to begin with, now with the news that they're exploring splitting a season in Milwaukee. Or not Milwaukee, Montreal, rather.
I think there was a lot of interest in the late 2000s when they made the World Series run into the early 2010s. There was a lot of interest. Like, I went to a game in 2013 that was peak Lincecum against peak Price and Will Myers at a walk-off. And it was the loudest I'd ever heard of a baseball stadium.
Really?
It was, the indoors helps. But, I mean, it was damn close to sold out, and the crowd loved it. So there was definitely interest, but I feel like it's just kind of gotten mundane for them. And there's nothing new to excite them in Tampa. So that news is interesting, to say the least, but I do think there was interest for a sustained period of time.
Sure. One more counterpoint on that AL East outlook, and then we'll go to Larry. I think Boston, you said the magic has run out. I think Boston's still a sleeping giant. I mean, they have a great roster, and I know they've got to catch 2 good ball clubs in the Yankees and Rays. But, you know, if they could sneak into the postseason as a wild card team, which it looks like that, I mean, they've got a good chance to do that in a race with Cleveland and Texas. I don't know. Boston, I think you're not quite giving them enough credit.
I give them credit, but I just think they've kind of... I think they came into the season way too high on themselves. I think it was like, we're the best, and there's nothing you can do about it. And they got off cold, and they haven't rebounded. And I'm waiting for that stretch in August where they rebound. And look, the Yankees in the 70s came back from 14 down in late July. You know, 14 games back in the division to win the division against Boston. So I'm prepared for anything in the East, but I'm not totally sold on this Boston team. I don't think it's all there. And yes, they beat up on us in the postseason last year, but I just don't think it's there. And if we play them in the division series, I would be just as scared as playing Minnesota. Well, I'd be a little more scared because Minnesota's not really, you know, Matt, Minnesota's not really that great. And then Houston, we're beating up on them right now. We took the first two of four games today and tomorrow in that series. I'm pretty confident. I mean, but Boston, you don't know. I'm not writing them off, but I'm getting more comfortable, which might be dangerous.
I will point out real quick before we slide it over to Larry that Minnesota has a better record than New York right now, 49-26, New York 48-27. So Larry, now tell us a little bit about the Cubs, 41-37 as we film this, 4-6 in their last 10, leading the division by a game and a half over Milwaukee. It's another race where I feel like, you know, there are some good teams in the mix, Milwaukee and St. Louis, very respectable clubs, Cincinnati and Pittsburgh still in the hunt, likely don't have enough. How do you see it playing out?
Definitely intriguing division, as it always tends to be. I think it's really a two-horse race right now at the moment between Chicago and Milwaukee. And St. Louis, you can never really count them out, but I still think that they're the third-best team in this division. And the Cubs, especially with the most recent signing of Craig Kimbrell, definitely have enough to win the divisions. But Brewers always dangerous, and that's not a team you can sleep on. The Cubs have that 1.5 game lead right now, but quite frankly, they haven't been playing their best baseball, and they haven't played their best baseball in quite a while. They're just playing like a team that can't get hot. They can't seem to put a win streak together. They're playing decent at the end of April. They kind of got off to a slow start, but here we are in a dogfight with Milwaukee yet again, and I really think that Craig Kimbrell signing can provide a spark. The bullpen has also been very inconsistent. They've seen flashes from Carl Edwards Jr. starting the season very poorly. He's bounced back a little bit. Pedro Strop always finding himself on and off the injured list, and that's plagued them a little bit. And their lineup has remained pretty consistent, but it just comes down to closing and finishing games.
Absolutely. Chicago right now as it stands, and I didn't realize this, but they have the worst record of any division leader at 41-34. Compare that with the Dodgers over in the West, who have the best record of any division leader currently, 52-25. I think that the thing to watch this season, there are going to be some good wild card races. Somehow, my Texas Rangers are in the hunt, a team that no one really expected to do much of anything. And, you know, but that American League race, you're going to have Cleveland, you're going to have Boston, Tampa, of course. I don't think I mentioned them earlier. And then in the National League, just as interesting with, you know, St. Louis, San Diego, you know, Philadelphia, a lot of teams, Colorado and Milwaukee. A lot of
every
teams.
Every year we.
You what? Go, no, you're good.
No, I was going to say every year, like, we try to pencil in multiple teams from the AL East. And then it's like, well, there's two other divisions to worry about. You know, the Central can definitely put one in. The West can put one in. We always try to...
I don't...
The three teams. The AL Central is not good at all. It's terrible. So the Twins are going to be the only team out of that division. And then it comes down to the West. So if the A's can sneak in. But I think it's definitely a AL East powerhouse, the American League at least. So give yourself some credit, Josh.
I wouldn't be surprised if Cleveland tries to sneak in a wild card. Look, I'm the king of giving myself credit with the Yankees. Like, I built that team in my head. So don't worry about me giving myself credit. But there is definitely opportunities. But we always seem to write in the three teams from the East. And I wouldn't be surprised if Tampa and Boston play in the wild card game.
I will say right now, what's the date? June 21st? June 22nd? 22nd. I will say right now on June 22nd.
June 22nd.
Yep. It will be Tampa and Boston in that wild card game. And as much as I am a Rangers fan, I think they will probably lose steam down the stretch. I'm rooting for them, of course, but I think that it will be three teams from the AL East getting into the playoffs. That's what I'm saying.
Well, we'll find out. I can't say I'd be too disappointed to watch Boston and Tampa go at each other.
No, it would be a good game. And, you know, I would like to see Tampa with some success before they move to Montreal. We'll see how it plays out.
Halfway.
Well, they would play. I think the arrangement would be the first half of each season in Tampa, then the second half in Montreal. So I don't know.
That's what I heard too.
I don't know how they would split it up if that goes through and then they qualify for a postseason. I don't know how they would split that up. That would be interesting. I know. I will say that Major League Baseball's Instagram page tweeted out a picture of Olympic Stadium yesterday. Or not tweeted out, posted a picture of Olympic Stadium yesterday. So,
interesting.
Yeah. Perhaps cryptic. Now to an area where, Larry, you've had some success making predictions. Bradley basketball. You predicted last time you were on my show that they would make a tournament within 2 years. Well, we made a tournament this past year. That's the shirt I'm wearing. Moving into the 2019-2020 season, what can some expectations for the Braves be?
Obviously, the expectations are very high coming into the season. Like you said, you heard it first on the Joey Wright Show. All your viewers found out that Bradley was going to make the tournament in the next 2 years, and they did just that. But the thing with mid-major basketball is it's very, very unpredictable, and Bradley has a very respectable roster coming back this year, and they're definitely going to be a contender for the Missouri Valley regular season title, but when it's all said and done, it's whoever wins that tournament, whoever can get high, is going to make it into the big dance. And last year, it was Bradley. And I feel like the key for this Bradley Braves team this season is going to be staying hot all throughout the year. They started the conference season 0-5 last year, and that was a big issue. And now, this year, they've got a lot of veteran experience coming back. Their top three scorers are returning. And a lot of question marks lie in their recruiting class. Not necessarily question marks. They've got a lot of good young talent, but it's really going to be up to them to step in and fill the shoes of graduating seniors like D'Lo and Lukman Lundy, guys that really stepped up and commanded a veteran presence on the floor and in the locker room.
Yep, Lukman Lundy put the team on his back against Northern Iowa and was a big part of that come-from-behind win in the conference championship game. And yeah, you mentioned staying consistent is going to be a big thing for the Braves this year. That 0-5 start in conference play, no MVC team had ever started 0-3 and won the conference tournament, let alone 0-5. Bradley, the first to do that. Josh, what's your take on the upcoming season for the Bradley Braves? And I will say, before you go, it's only June. I mean, you know, so this is perhaps a way too early preview of Bradley basketball, but how do you see it playing out?
The one thing I want to tack on to Larry's point is the two bad out-of-conference losses, losing to Eastern Illinois and IUPUI. Those are two losses that really set the Braves back and create some negative momentum. So winning your winnable out-of-conference game is going to be huge. I could see them winning again. I mean, you look at the main contenders in the conference. Loyola is losing Custer and Towns, I believe. Yes, Marcus Towns. And Illinois State was kind of rocky last year, didn't have a great year. I could see, it was really open. Bradley is probably the most proven with the most veteran leadership. Like Larry said, the top three scorers are coming back. It's really anyone's conference, but like you said, the key is going to be staying consistent, staying ready to go all the time, and not creating opportunities where you can spiral down. You can't guarantee that you're going to come out of that spiral every year. You know, they came out of the spiral this year, and they got really hot at the really right time, but that's far from a guarantee every year.
Absolutely. Now, guys, what road games are we road tripping to this year? I know a goal before we graduate was to cross every MVC arena off the list. We're at three right now. Where are we going?
Well, Joey, I know you're really hot on the idea of road tripping it to Memphis.
I am.
Because the rumors were spiraling around that Bradley is going to get Memphis on the schedule, obviously with Darryl Brown. He's a senior this year, and he's from Memphis, and that Memphis team looks really strong, so I feel like that would be a hard opportunity to pass up.
Yeah, even if it's on a Wednesday, or, you know, wherever it may fall, I hope that we can make that work. It'd be worth it. I think it'd be like a 12-hour round trip. So, but
see, I would be very much in favor of that. I'm just looking at it right now. It's a 6-hour, 20-minute drive from Peoria to Memphis. So if we're going to do that, you guys are going to have to get over your fear of letting a New Yorker share the driving. So I'm very game, but we'll have to see if it logistically works out. Obviously, we'd have to try to not miss as much class as possible and still try to be, you know, students at college, because that's what we are, but
right.
It would definitely be a lot of fun.
Well, I'm saying the game would be in November or December, so as long as we've got all our ducks in a row, by that point, you know, you would think that we could maybe get away. Obviously, the goal would be to not miss any class. Man, I can't talk today, but you know, we would see how that would play out. So as we begin to run out of time, Josh, I want to switch back to you for a minute. Obviously, you mentioned you're from New York. That's a big part of your personality, big part of your brand. And you've recently made the move to Atlanta. Tell us a little bit about that. I imagine that, first of all, Atlanta is a great community, and you know, there's a lot to do there. But I imagine that's still a bit of a jarring transition.
Yeah, it's different than New York. I mean, it's still a metro city area. There's still, you know, you can still walk places. I mean, I have fallen. It is a driving city, kind of, and we do have a car here, so I really felt lazy yesterday when I drove five blocks to Five Guys. Granted, it was 95 degrees, but it's different. You know, my whole life was kind of set up in New York, and I had everything looking forward to this summer, and then second week of March kind of turned upside down, but it's good. Can't complain. I mean, everything is, we have a great apartment and great situation here, so could be a lot worse.
Absolutely, and you get to watch as many baseball games as you want at SunTrust Park. I went 2 years ago. Well, beautiful facility.
It's a weird situation. So I actually, it's in Cobb County, and there, mm-hmm. when they say there's no public transportation out there, there is no public transportation out there from the downtown Midtown Atlanta area. So I actually did a hike the other day at Kennesaw Mountain, which is, I did a 2.1 mile loop, and I was driving out there, and it cuts through Cobb County. It was something about half an hour to get there. And so I'm thinking to myself, you have to drive this half an hour to a Braves game. Everybody's driving. It just kind of, it doesn't make a lot of sense. So I do plan on getting out there for a night game. Definitely not a day game. It is really hot here. But
yeah,
it's a good situation. And ticket prices, sources say, are much cheaper than Yankee Stadium, which is good.
Well, I don't think it takes a genius to figure that one out. The Yankees are known for charge. I mean, it's like $1,000 to sit behind home plate at Yankee Stadium. I mean, it's,
I think, closer to $1,200 or $1,300.
Yeah, I mean,
it's crazy. Season.
Yeah, Larry, I know you're a fan of Family Sundays at Guaranteed Rate Field. Much cheaper to do that.
Oh, absolutely. That's one thing the White Sox do great is lower the ticket prices to make sure the whole family can come to the ballpark. Something my favorite team is not very good at, and I hope they can improve upon that. And for that reason, I'm a big fan of the White Sox organization.
Absolutely. And I went up there for a game, would have been in May, early May. And it's, you know, it's an economical ballpark. It's nice. I like Guaranteed Rate Field. You know, it doesn't cost too much to go to a Sox game.
It's a good place to watch a ball game. It gets the job done. It's nothing special. It's not Wrigley Field, but it's very convenient, right off the expressway, and it's easy to get around the ballpark, and a good place for a family outing.
Absolutely. So, guys, we are about out of time. I want to start. I can't have you both go at once here. I'll start with you, Larry. Anything else you want to add? Great to have you back on the Joey Wright Show.
Well, it was good to have a good conversation yet again, and I'm looking forward to going back to school in the fall, and I'm sure we'll stay busy after even a busy summer for all of us, I'm sure.
Absolutely. Josh?
Yeah, I'll just touch on one more thing. This is the Joey Wright Show on Urbana Public Television, and there is a pretty significant Urbana-Atlanta connection coming up. Atlanta is known for the Peachtree Road Race, which every year is a 10-kilometer road race, 6.2 miles, on July 4th from the major mall, Lenox Square Mall, to Piedmont Park in Midtown Atlanta. It runs on Peachtree Street. Georgia is known for their Georgia peaches, and the mecca of wheelchair racing is centered in Urbana, Illinois. So actually, last week they announced the contenders of the elite field, and the last year's champion, Susanna Scaroni, is based in Champaign, Urbana. She'll be coming back to defend her Peachtree title. Tatiana McFadden is the best female wheelchair marathoner in the world. She'll be coming back, and the men's champion last year, all three of them based in Urbana, Daniel Romanchuk, who's only 20, will be coming back to defend his Peachtree title. So it's a huge Urbana contingency coming to Atlanta on July 4th and racing for the win. So 50,000 people will be doing that race. I'll be one of them, hopefully finishing. And the Urbana wheelchair racing group will have a good day, I guess. It's going to be a lot of fun.
I won't be able to watch their race. They'll set off at about 6:35, and then I'll be in the first wave of masses with the elite men going off at 7. So I won't get to see them, but I'm sure I'll hear about it afterwards.
Absolutely. Hopefully you're hearing about a victory. And Tatiana McFadden, I will say, a huge name around here, obviously. All that she does in the sport of wheelchair marathoning is nothing short of amazing. So
she was beaten last year by her teammate Scaroni, who she's defending her title. They're both going to race again. It's a really interesting course because for foot racing, but also wheelchair racing, because it goes, the 6 mile course goes straight downhill the first half and straight uphill the second half. So it's like, how much confidence do you have in your wheelchair control in the first half to just kind of roll? And then you have to really be able to push the last 3 miles uphill, which gets tough on foot and with your arms in a wheelchair. So we'll see.
Absolutely. A lot of elevation in that Atlanta area. So, guys, again, thank you so much for joining me today. Larry, of course, we thank you for joining us on short notice. I asked you to do this about an hour and a half before we came on. So we definitely appreciate that, and we hope to have you back on again. We'll have more from Josh Schwamm after the break. You're watching Urbana Public Television and The Joey Wright Show. Even if your hope has burned with time, anything that's touched shall be regret. And your vicious pain, your warning sign, you will be fine. That's about all the time we have today. Big thank you again to Larry Larson, who joined us on short notice this afternoon. At about 9:30 this morning, Shea Barney, the guest that was supposed to join Josh and I, had another commitment pop up, so he had to bow out, but Larry Larson stepped in and filled in for us like a champ, as he always does. I've still got Josh Schwamm on the line with me, and Josh, you are going to take us to the end of the program with a love letter to Boston fans. Take it away.
Yeah, there's nothing that I love more than hating on Red Sox fans, New England fans. They love to hate on the Yankees just because we're the Yankees. They love to hate on the Giants just because we're the Giants. It's New York. How could you not hate New York? It's the thing to do. They're obnoxious. They take everything personally. When we win or do something to try to win, it's to personally offend Boston, their families, their beliefs, their values. Everything is personal to that Boston fan. The Yankees have resources. We use them. Derek Jeter, when the Marlins and the Yankees made that trade, I don't know if that trade was doctored, but the Marlins took a lot of that contract. We use our resources. We have money to spend. They have money to spend, too. They just blew their last two big signings with Chris Sale and David Price.